Dragi telespectatori, urmează a treia parte dintr-un studiu al vieții de după moarte, întocmit prin grija neurochirurgului Dr. Maurice Rawlings din Statele Unite. Cei care ați văzut episoadele anterioare sunt convins că v-au impresionat, așa cum m-au impresionat și pe mine și impresionează pe orice om care își pune problematica aceasta a vieții de după moarte, care își pune întrebarea: există iad, există rai, există Dumnezeu? Vom urmări deci partea a treia și ultima și sperăm ca aceste imagini, aceste realități mai degrabă să vă afecteze profund emoțional, dar în sensul de a ne conștientiza că trebuie să fim pregătiți pentru plecarea dincolo, pentru viața de după moarte. Vă dorim vizionare plăcută și multă binecuvântare de la Dumnezeu.
Many people are trying to dilute the message of hell, the message of heaven, saying that neither of these worlds exist. Why not eat, drink and be merry? If there is no accountability, then there is no sin. And if there's no sin, Christ died in vain. And if Christ died in vain, what do we need God for? This is the new philosophy of the new age, that there is no hell. It is the hope of most people. There is no hell. On the other hand, people are going to visit our loved ones in the hospital with a new message of a new age that is the exact opposite. It's called the religion of NDEers, the religion of near-death experiencers. Look, I went to heaven, they tell the patient that's dying. And I saw the light. And I came back, all is well. There is no accountability. There is no hell. Heaven's gates are open wide for everyone who dies. Look at me, I'm an atheist, I'm here. You don't have to worry. Death is nothing to be feared. I'm going to stay with you. Your family's too afraid to stay with you while you're dying, but I'm not. Let me hold your hand. Let me tell you about this glorious thing that's coming to get you, this beautiful light at the end of the tunnel, where there is no worry, no loss, only gain. You're acceptable as you are. There is no heaven. There is no hell. It's eternity for all. And this is the new age called the Omega Faith, where everybody goes to heaven. And this is the group that's coming into our hospitals now, counseling the dying instead of our church groups counseling the dying. The dying is the most neglected ministry of all ministries we have. Nobody wants it. Everybody's afraid of the dying patient. And the dying patient wants to know what dying is all about. Does it hurt? Is there life after death? Is there heaven after hell? How can I make sure that I'm going to get to heaven? And you can tell them. It's a free gift. You can tell them how to get it. But if we don't defend ourselves against the Omega faith and these people infiltrating the hospitals now with a faith that's deadly, nothing, that the world is nothing, then we're going to lose our own Christianity. The patient will die naked without any faith at all. We'd like to introduce the case of Dr. Whitaker, who's still in practice, an atheist at the time, had nothing to do with God. But there's a situation that occurred that changed his life, and we'd like you to experience it with him.
It was February of 1975. At that time, I was an alcoholic out of control. I was also using recreation drugs, but primarily alcohol was my drug of choice. And I totally was out of control. And I had a lot of friends in the entertainment business, and Hoyt Axton happened to be one of them, Ringo Starr, and a bunch of people. And so they were having a TV special on the West Coast. And so Hoyt had called me and asked me if I would like to go or come out. And I told him, yeah, I would love to, because I knew there was going to be a lot of booze. I knew there was going to be partying. And while they were doing their special, I was doing my thing. And so after about 3 or 4 days out there, I became ill, and by ill I mean I had a severe pain in my abdomen. I flew into Oklahoma City and called a senator friend of mine and told him I had to have a car because I was ill, I was sick. So they sent a car and they took me home, and I checked into the hospital at Wadley Hospital in Texarkana in February of 1975. I checked in with electrolytes, which means my potassium, my chlorides, and various chemicals were so far out of balance that they had to give me IVs to build me up. Now, at that time in my life, I was an atheist. I was a hardcore atheist and was living for myself. Atheists are self-centered and they live for themselves. And this is where I found myself in 1975 in the hospital. And they took 3 days and then they operated me. And when they operated me, I found myself in intensive care. I woke up on a respirator, which means they were breathing for me. I couldn't speak, but I, you know, and I had been laying there in a coma, and I had heard these people talk about how sick I was and how I was going to die and how I wouldn't get out of the hospital. And at that time my hair was very, very long because I just wore my hair long, and I heard one guy say, his hair is long, and another guy said, not nearly as long as it's going to be before he gets out of here. And a third voice said, he's not going to get out of here, he's going to die. And after 3 days I could breathe on my own. And I remember my doctor, my surgeon, a guy by the name of Donald Duncan, he told me, he says, Don, if you have anything to get right, if you have anything to get signed, you get it done, because we're not sure. We're not sure how long you have. So I knew, see, I had a condition that was called acute hemorrhagic necrotic pancreatitis. You don't live with this disease. Now, you can live with pancreatitis. You can even live with acute pancreatitis. But you do not live with acute hemorrhagic necrotic pancreatitis. Duncan had told my two sons that I would be dead before morning. They didn't expect me to survive. And, you know, I'm laying there. Now, I'm a professed atheist. And when I say a professed atheist, I didn't believe in God. I believed in the power of the universe because I'd seen it. You know, I'd seen it, life and death. As a physician, I dealt with life and death. I believed in something, but don't talk to me about God, and surely don't talk to me about a resurrection or a virgin birth or this type of thing, because I am in research science. PhDs in research science, the majority of them do not believe in God. They do not believe in a supreme being. They believe, and they're beginning now to believe, that there is order in the universe, because as we get farther and farther along, we see the order. But I was an atheist. Now, see, it's very easy to be an atheist when you're successful. You have worked your way from Oklahoma welfare to being one of the most powerful men in your part of the country, one of the most powerful men in the state of Oklahoma in relationship to political. It's very easy to be an atheist when you have done all of that. Man can sit back and say, I don't need God. What is God? But it's very difficult to be an atheist when you're laying on your deathbed, because you begin to think, what if these people are right? See, there'd been one man by the name of Ron Short that has stood between me and the gates of hell. One man that had witnessed to me about the love of Jesus for 5 years before I became ill. One man. And, you know, I would debate him. And I liked him because he did what he said he was going to do. I mean, he was the only one that I saw that professed to be Christian that lived what he said he was going to do. And so I really respected him. I didn't believe what he said, but I respected him. But when I'm laying on my deathbed and knowing that I'm going to die, guess who I thought about? I thought about, what if Ron is right? What if there is a heaven and a hell? And so the most immediately immediately the most pressing thought in my mind is, how do I get saved? What is saved? What is saved? How do I get saved? And so I sent them for Ron Short. I wanted him to come down because I wanted him to do ever what he had to do. I had no idea. How can a man hanging on a tree in Israel 2,000 years ago, what is that to me? But I knew that he had something that I had to have. And that night, see, I had him go for Ron, but Ron wasn't home. Ron was in Alabama. And so I had him go and send for Ron. And that night was the longest night that I've ever had in my entire life, before or since. And that night is as I would be laying there in bed. As I'm laying there in bed, I would begin to fade away. I would begin to fade away, and as I would fade away, I would begin to go down. Now, it was like darkness. It was so, so dark. It was like the very darkness just penetrated into your very, very being. And as I left, and I can tell you I left my body because I remember when I came back into my body. You know, I don't know where I was out of my body. Now, there are people that talk about a light. There are people that talk about floating above. There are people that talk about a feeling of warmth and love. I didn't feel any of that. I felt none of that. I felt untold terror. Untold terror. Because I knew that if I ever went all the way, if I slipped all the way, I would never get back. Now, in my beings of beings, I knew that. And so I fought all night long. They told me later on, I not only pulled the mattress cover off of the mattress, I pulled the mattress up on me because I had to stay. I had to wait. I had to wait till Ron got there. Whatever he had to do, I had to wait. But I would, again, and then I would leave, and I would be going down like a deep, deep, dark terror. Now, my skin began to get cold. Now, it's not like cold when you walk out into the air. It's like bone chilling cold in my lower extremities. And you can feel the coldness begin to come up the legs. And again, I would begin to leave. Now, and I would be in that darkness, and I'd be in that void. And I remember one time entering back in my body, because when I entered my body, it was like, just like that. I felt my body thud, my physical body thud when I entered back in. Now, believe me, that is the most horrifying, terrifying experience that I've ever encountered. And I fought all night long. And the next morning, somewhere 9:30, 10 o'clock, in came Ron. And Ron came in and he says, "Dr. Whitaker, what do they say is your chances?" I said, "Ron, they tell me I have none." He says, "Now's the time." And I said, "You're right." I mean, I'd cursed him, I'd spit at him, but now was the time, because I had to have whatever he had, because I had a short period of time on earth, and I didn't know, have any idea when I might make that trip and go all the way. At that time, Ron led me simply in the sinner's prayer. Now, I had no idea what the sinner's prayer was, but I trusted Ron. But he led me in the sinner's prayer and told me that Jesus had died for my sins. He had died for the sins of the world. I didn't quite understand that, but I knew, you know, he showed me in the Word of God where it said that. Now, you have to understand, I'm a man of books. I've spent a big part of my life, 25, 26 years of my life, in books, in, you know, all types of scientific books, chemistry, like I said, degree in chemistry, advanced degrees, all the way out to the medicine doctor to practice medicine, all of these degrees. So he told me, and I believed him, because it's in this book, and it was a new book unto me, and it was called the Bible. And so I led, I let Ron lead me in the sinner's prayer, and I said the sinner's prayer after him. And I can tell you one thing. There was a peace that came over me like I had never known. I'd searched for that peace. I'd searched for it in the bottles, alcohol. I'd searched for it in needles. I'd searched for it in drugs. I'd searched for it with women. I'd searched for it all types of places. But there was no peace in my life. But once I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, I was no longer afraid. I still believed I was going to die because I knew the condition I had is that you do not survive it. I knew that. I'm a physician. I knew what I had, you did not survive. And he shows me in the Word of God, it says, these signs shall follow those that believe. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. I walk around on planet Earth this day, taking no insulin, taking no enzymes, eating whatsoever that I might, and God produces in my body every day the correct material for me to function without having to take medication. You know, when you see blind eyes open, you see the cripples walk, you see the leopards cleansed, and you see them with your own eyes, you know, you see that, then it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that, you know, the Bible is true.
How can the various stages of hell have different aspects to them? Well, the Bible doesn't say it's all fire. If you look at different places, it's cast out, separated from God, total darkness, where the worm cannot die. Most of it is flame. But there are some that can't visualize this, like Rodaniel that we'll introduce, and Whitaker, Dr. Whitaker. Seeing the angel of light can be deceptive in some cases. For instance, 2 Corinthians 11:14, even Satan can change himself into an angel of light and deceive many. Which light did they see at the end of the tunnel? Especially if it was someone that didn't think they deserved to be in heaven. Those things occur. Strangely enough, the opposite does not occur. Those that saw themselves in hell knew exactly where they belong. They never questioned why they were put there. In fact, Christ talked about this himself in Matthew 25. He says, if Satan cast out Satan, sent hell as an imaginary picture, how would his kingdom stand? How would it hold together? No, impossible. But no, as an angel of light, Satan can deceive many. But this variation that they see in hell, whether it's total darkness, or whether it's the fire, it's a place that they never want to visit again. This brings us to the case of Dr. Rodinia, George Rodinia, a young Russian fellow, very intelligent, became a PhD and MD, but before that had trouble with the KGB and couldn't get out of Russia. In fact, when he tried to get out of Russia, he was purposely run down by the KGB, overriding the sidewalk and running over him. And this is how his accident started and his story started.
As a psychiatrist, as a neuropathologist, for me, God never existed. I never believed in God. I never believed in the Bible. I never thought about God or Bible or divinity. In 1976, I was 20 when I was already a doctor working in Georgia. I met a lady from Texas, and I tried to leave the country many times, but I didn't have such a help. This lady tried to help me, and I became in big trouble with KGB. Because my work, I worked on adenosine triphosphate, it's a neurotransmitter in our brain, and with the conjunction of oxytocin, I discovered several things, and I was a scientist, and KGB didn't want me to go, so that's why they decided to kill me. That's how I got into another dimension of my life. I was standing on the sidewalk, ready to depart to New York, waiting for a cab. when car ran on the sidewalk and hit me. I flew 10 meters and I fell and then ran. The car runs over me. My friends and relatives took me to hospital, and the hospital staff, friends of mine, and two other professors declared me dead. They put me in morgue in a freezer, and 3 days later they took me out on Monday. It was Friday night, and on Monday morning they began my autopsy. And these 3 days being out of my body, seeing everything what was happening around, seeing myself, my body, seeing my birth, my parents, my wife, my child, my friends, I saw their thoughts, I saw what they were thinking, how they how their thought moved from one to another dimension. It was incredible experience. I was in darkness, in total darkness, and this darkness was pressing. This darkness existed not beyond, but existed within. What I want to say is that darkness was pressing, and I was in the middle of this sphere, and I didn't understand why and how this darkness existed. Where was I? And I understood I didn't have a body because I didn't feel it. But then I thought about light. I went through that little hall into light. But light was more powerful, more burning. I mean, you cannot compare it to anything. No word can explain it. And this light was so burning and going through flesh. But I didn't have a body. That was the most interesting part. And I was scared of that light. I thought, where is that hall to darkness, go to shade, to save myself from this light? What is that light? I don't know. I mean, it can be called light of God. It can be called light of life. But light is light and darkness is darkness. And then, as a psychiatrist and scientist, I didn't think about that. The only thing was that I was in light. We were not raised in God. You know, Soviet Union, we didn't go to church. We didn't have... There were people who went. But they were some kind of limited people, we thought. I mean, we thought they didn't know better that there is no God. But during that 3 days being in morgue, in a freezer, changed all my life. To begin the autopsy, they began to cut my chest. That was the first incision. Then I opened eyes. So when I opened eyes and he saw the pupils were convulsing, becoming smaller, to say simply, he saw that it was reacting on light. It means it's life. And they put me back into hospital and began resuscitation. My lungs were collapsed for many time. I mean, long time. I was on respirator for 90 days. I mean, it's not that it happened fast, but the life came back. And what they discovered was that life was there during the autopsy, but it wasn't that all organs worked. I mean, it was hard work for 9 months being under the recovery. It didn't happen immediately. I mean, the life was there, but it doesn't mean that I could survive if not doctors who helped me to regenerate my health and organs. When I came to life back, a lot of different experiences happened, and I experienced a lot of rejection, a lot of fight with the reality of others, but nothing could change my mind. I knew my destination, I knew my way, and I decided to leave the country. And again, this lady from Longview, Texas, helped me to move to United States, and we came to Texas, and we continued to live in Texas still. Sometimes things are beyond our grasp, but I don't try to explain it all, because I know and I believe that God knows better, and I believe that I don't need to be explained. And why it was shown to me and why it's me chosen to be, it wasn't questioned, and I don't care about that, honestly. I care that it was. I deeply believe in God of love. and God is love. And I believe that God, God created everything for betterness and for incredible, incredible future, if we don't ruin it.
All of these hell-like cases had one thing in common. Surprise, they didn't know there was such a place. Will you find it a surprise? Will I find it a surprise? Or will we be prepared? Hell is nothing new. It's been there. It's just something discovered by some people that died and came back, and they want to tell you about it.
And I experienced what is love, what is faith, what is hope, and all these three as a wisdom of God.
The prayer of faith, the prayer of salvation, is not some just little prayer. It's the only way to the Father. And that's the only way. Now, all of these people that in the New Age movement that believe that everybody's going to heaven, that you can worship anything, you worship a flea, you can squeeze a tree, you can worship a crystal, you can worship a star. I got news for them. They're not going. Unless they accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, because the Word says the only way to the Father is through the Son.
Don't go to hell. Please, I beg you, don't go to hell. It was not prepared for you.
If you're saved, you're saved to that. If you accept Jesus.
Do not put off for tomorrow anything, because you might die this very moment, this very night.
It's the best sight ever happened in your life.
You can feel Jesus' presence with you like today, in this place, in this time.
It's not God's will that people perish. I didn't know this. I didn't know the love of God. All I knew was hatred and violence and abuse. But there's one that cares, and his name is Jesus.
And who is the Son? He's the Word made flesh and came and dwelt amongst men. The Word is the way to the Father.
Make a choice. Not tomorrow, not tonight. Make a choice right now. Are you going to give your heart over to Jesus, or are you not?
If you want to have life hereafter, you better accept Jesus.
Friends, you've heard the evidence. This is as close as you're going to get to making a decision. Is there life after death? Are these people that we've presented to you turning their lives upside down because there is a heaven and there is a hell? Have you made a decision in your own life? Do you know if you die tonight, you would be with God in heaven tomorrow? And remember the adage from Revelation 3:15. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. God is knocking right now. If you hear me, open the door and I will come in. I will come in, not might come in, and fellowship with you and you with me. It means you come dirty just like you are. He'll fellowship and tell you how to clean up your life. And meanwhile, in exchange, give you this free gift of eternal life with Jesus Christ because you're one of his. You're now a Christian. Thank you, friends, for coming tonight.